is it. We're on the air.
It's a big show.
So this is a really big show. But
welcome
you know
back,
who says
everyone.
That? It's, yes, we're back. Ed Sullivan used to say that. Really big show. This has been a dream for years to have this culminated like this, to have you here. And I've been tittering and so excited that you're here with us. And SUZY, we've been planning and dreaming this thing for a long time. And all of a sudden, one day, it's here. So welcome to NJ Discover Live TV. Before we jump in, of course, Gilbert Gottfried and SUZY YENGO, we've been promoting, the excitement is beyond, which is one of my favorite words, beyond how excited we are to have you here. Before we even do that, I like to do some promo stuff. So Gilbert Gottfried is going to be, this is great, Catch a Rising Star. Joey Harrison's Fork and River, July 21st, Catch a Rising Star. That's a great venue because there's water right near there.
Yes.
It's a wonderful venue. It really is. And it's in a place that nobody knows exists. So that's one thing. The other thing, and we'll talk about it, I've been watching Gilbert Gottfried's amazing, colossal podcast, which is on gilbertpodcast.com. You can subscribe to it on iTunes. It is, we'll talk about it. It's simply wonderful. And the last thing it wasn't a watch, it was a listen, was when you had Emmett Walsh. It was like, wow, what an amazing, the stuff you do on that. It's just, it's like I may take the next year to just sit and listen. The things you learn, it was just, what an amazing podcast. So that's number two. Number three, Gilbert, the documentary, which I've now watched twice in a short period of time, and I love, and we'll talk about it, is available on Hulu, iTunes, Amazon, or go to gilbertmovie.com. So now, and this is tradition, it gives me a great pleasure to introduce my co-host, the ebullient, she's ebullient, and vivacious, Tara Jean Vitale, and we're basically at our anniversary, seventh, I always say this, but yeah. We're just about there, that date when we discovered each other 7 years ago.
Yeah, isn't there like a 7 year itch thing?
Oh, that's bad. Am I bumping into you?
Sorry. All right.
So, Tara Jean Vitale, welcome.
Thank you. And introducing Calvin, the man with the hat. If it wasn't for you, we wouldn't be here. He's he brings in the best guests and he does all the work. So, I'm just here to help you out.
It's fine. It's fine. Listen, I'm a card carrying member of AARP, and I've been that way. It's my 17th year of being a card-carrying member of AARP. Isn't that staggering? I mean, really. And so I have the time to do this stuff and explore New Jersey, which is, and I'm waving to my son, Neil, who I'm so proud that you're here. And we have a nice studio audience, and I'm waving to everybody. So we're going to jump in. Start off, and I want to introduce SUZY YENGO. Met a few years ago, and you have so graciously taken me into the world of wonderful Catch a Rising Star comedy. And I've been hanging out at this amazing Princeton Club, and I've met some wonderful comedians there and did some journalism. And so a little bit about, a little bio, SUZY. You're the CEO of Catch a Rising Star Comedy Club, so throw a little bio out and then we'll come to Gilbert shortly.
Sure.
Okay.
So, the commonality point, Gilbert and his wife Dara met at Tavern on the Green. I don't know what year. Do you remember what year?
No.
Oh, come on.
No, I actually don't.
things. In the 90s, maybe?
I think I know. 20 years ago.
Oh, okay.
Because I've done my research.
See?
20 years ago.
See? So just ask him.
Okay. No, don't ask me.
Ask him everything. And I had worked there for 18 years as the director of entertainment and special events. So our paths kind of crossed, even though I didn't know they were there that day. In that way. And since then, while I was there, I went to law school and I became an entertainment attorney. And then left for a few years and got involved in Catch a Rising Star. And here I am today.
Yeah. Now, when you started with Catch a Rising Star, did you start in what position?
I was just an investor when I started, and then the person who got us all together passed away. And I was the obvious choice to run the company because nobody else had my experience.
And they have more than one location.
Yes.
Where else?
We're in Princeton. We're now in Forked River. We have series all over the country. Delray Beach, Florida, Connecticut, Providence, Rhode Island, and soon to be a few surprise locations.
Oh, wonderful.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Comedy clubs are wonderful. People really, really need that.
They do.
And you know what I mean? You need to just listen to people. Although in a lot of comedy clubs, I'm afraid to sit in the front of the theater. I'll always sit in the back because I'm sure. Don't you pick out the people in the front when you're doing your stand-up?
Not really. No. I was never, yeah.
You don't really pick on people?
Not for the most part.
And I've seen a couple of scenes with you because I was watching a lot of YouTube of you too, where some people walk out and you'll
I usually... I usually time it to see, you know, like if they walk out in the middle or later, I feel like I could have lost them earlier in my younger days. Damn it, yeah. I'm slipping.
That's funny. Yeah, well, I've never walked out, but I've definitely sat in the back. But so, okay, so CEO now, and that's amazing. You're bringing a lot of really big names from what I can see.
Yes.
Yeah, and Gilbert will be tonight.
Tonight in Princeton, yeah. Catch a Rising Star. We've been there for over 20 years, actually, at the Hyatt in Princeton.
Very nice. Do you do the same stand-up every time, or do you switch it up?
It depends. Sometimes it's the same. Other times, sometimes it'll be different. Other times it's so much the same that I'm up there going, so, how many of you watch Bonanza? Where you go, it's really time to write something new.
Right.
Yeah.
Still on, I think.
Hey, a lot of Gunsmoke fans out there. Yeah. Hey, how many of you caught the Colgate Comedy Hour last week? Huh? Yeah.
I think I'm the only one in this room who knows that.
Yes.
Yes. I don't know what that means.
Here's my bit where I imitate all the people on Playhouse 90.
It's funny. I have to compose myself.
You have an interview to do.
So you bring in such amazing young talent to Catch a Rising Star, and talent on the way up, and I've experienced. How do you? What is the process of discovering, uncovering, recovering that kind of talent? I mean, i.e., Julia Scotti. You had brought her there, and I mean, such a bold and progressive. But your process. How do you go about that? Mm-hmm.
Well, I followed Julia when she was a he, and she's been in the business for a very long time.
Okay.
Julia was on America's Got Talent, so she gained some fame doing that, and we've been booking her before and after that, of course.
Okay.
I attend the Montreal Comedy Festival every year, so I meet a lot of comedians that way, and I'm always in clubs in New York City, where everyone goes, either L.A. or New York City. And I see lots of talent there all the time.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Quick question. You were, because I have your little resume sitting next to my desk for a long time, but you were at Tavern on the Green and the Russian Tea Room, and you did a lot of the entertainment, so you must have. And I know you did the First Lady, you arranged for the First Lady, correct?
Many times.
The First Lady and Michael Jackson.
His 30th anniversary in show business.
So you have under your belt just some amazing experiences and interactions. Any of those that you want to just chat about?
Well, I always thought the First Lady, Hillary Clinton, was amazing because she always remembered my name. And then I found out there's a little person behind her who whispers the name in her ear. That was still pretty cool had it. See, I got to work with Ray Charles at the Russian Tea Room, which is amazing. Worked with Michael Douglas and Catherine Zeta-Jones.
Wow.
We arranged their engagement party.
Wow.
You know, the owner of Tavern on the Green, Warner Leroy, was one of my idols, and I loved working with him. He had such an imagination. His dad was Warner Leroy, and Mervyn Leroy, who produced The Wizard of Oz. His dog was Toto. So he grew up, his whole life was based on that show.
What history.
Oh, it really, really was. So in every event that he ever did, he wanted something flying, he wanted midgets, and he wanted, you know, a yellow brick road.
Wow.
So we did a lot of those. Yeah.
The Wizard of Oz.
Yeah.
You know, I have a picture of Margaret Hamilton hanging over my side of the bed.
It's a little scary,
she's
Cal.
She's a hero. He knows that.
I don't know if I want to know about that.
No, okay, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I think let's just go right past that one.
I'm sorry. You're getting into the real cabin. Yeah. So, but
I have a picture of Thelma Ritter.
Well, that's pretty cool.
So, by the way, we have a lot of commonality. You have Thelma Ritter, I have Margaret Hamilton.
Yes.
And they're both about the same height.
Yes.
I don't know what that means. Oh, okay.
Maybe you should tell people who Thelma Ritter is who might not know.
She's just a great, great character actor. She used to play, a lot of times she played like a maid. But great voice, short stature, but a powerful. But that's before all your time, everybody right out there, including you, you know? So, but these are the things that I can identify with.
Right.
But I always talk about Margaret Hamilton, and I'm serious. She's just a great. A great lady.
Yeah.
She got typecast for the rest of her life because she was the Wicked Witch.
She popped up on an episode. This is really weird. She popped up on an episode of Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood.
No. Wow.
Yeah.
Really?
Wow.
Yeah.
Maybe he was teaching, you know, you could be a scary person.
Wow. That's so funny.
But yeah.
Wow. I'll have to Google that.
Yeah. I just, it's funny you mentioned, I just watched a thing with Fred Rogers, you know, when he testified in Washington with that senator about funding public television stuff. He was quite an amazing human being that you brought him up. But we're getting sidetracked.
Yes.
So you got to, listen, yes. You have to slap me.
Okay.
You know, like,
let's go back.
Like Margaret Hamilton used to.
Yes, slap me.
Let's talk about the documentary. Because that was.
Oh, yes.
Yes, the documentary. Now, how did this come about? Was this a.
Weird. It's kind of like I had nothing to do with it. This guy, well, the filmmaker's Neil Berkeley. And he said to me, I've always dreamt of doing a Gilbert Gottfried documentary. And I said, well, you should set your dreams a lot higher than that, you know. Maybe start off with a Yakov Smirnoff and work your way up. Like, you know, in America, you eat pizza. In Russia, pizza eats you. What a country. In America, you button your shirt. In Russia, your shirt buttons. Sure. And so, but then he just started following me around. It was just him with one camera, not even a cameraman with him. And I'm just too much of a wimp to say no. And I didn't want to do the documentary. And then he did it and finished it. And I still have a hard time watching it. But the reviews were amazingly great. I mean, I'm shocked by that.
Yeah.
It got all great reviews on Rotten Tomatoes and all those. Yeah.
It did. So you really don't watch it, though?
I watch it. I had to watch it because we were doing all these screenings. But boy, I mean, to me, it's like, you know, the first time you see yourself in a home movie or hear your voice on a recording and you go, no, that's not me. Mm-hmm. I'm not at all. That's the way I felt like.
Wow.
I was watching myself in the documentary going, wait a minute, do I really walk around like Red Fox in Sanford and Son? I just had, you know, You know, all I was missing was, you big dummy. You know, it's, I was waiting for Aunt Esther to come in the door.
It's funny you brought that up. I always, I get a lot of chest pains, and often I run around the house and I yell. Elizabeth, I'm coming. He knows that. I'm always getting chest pains. Always. So it's funny that you brought that up. I watched a documentary like twice recently, mm-hmm. and it is, it deserves every bit. And I, by the way, I'm a, this is important, Gilbert.
Yes.
I'm a Jersey guy, and Jersey guys who live in Monmouth County do not pander. So whatever I say.
I've heard this.
You've heard that.
You know, one thing I'll say about Jersey guys in Monmouth County, what I've noticed, they don't pander. I've always, sometimes I'll meet guys just at a party or whatever, and I notice that they're not pandering. And I'll say, are you from Jersey County? Because you didn't pander once.
All right, I get it. I get it. I get it. So, this is about as serious as I've ever been.
Yes.
I don't pander, but I loved the documentary.
Oh, thank you.
And it was funny, and it was also so real. And you know, you get all, you know, sometimes I'm a big guy, as you noticed. We took a picture together before.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm a big guy. And I got all choked up. It's just some, people should really see that, because they know your humor and your comedy. And then there's that wonderful side of you that, you know, nobody really sees, and it's just a great side. So it's a really, again, it's just a great documentary. Yes. And actually, to prove my pandering thing, I actually bought it.
Oh,
so I own
God.
It on Amazon.
Jeez.
So I didn't tell you that, but I bought, so I own your documentary.
Jeez.
So there you go.
So now, do you feel like there's a big difference in the way you are in people that you know and the way you present? Like, what people like us who don't know you personally and what we think of you, is it very different from who you really are?
It's weird. You know what was always a real uncomfortable thing? I don't know if you get this feeling as much as I do. It's like when you'll be with two different friends, mm-hmm. but you know them from different places. And somehow in your mind you're going, which me am I supposed to be?
Right, yeah. Right.
I have this set of jokes with this guy, uh-huh. mm-hmm. and this conversation with the, and it's like worlds crashing into each other.
Yeah, no, I agree with that. Like sometimes you don't have a party with those group of people and those group of people at your house because you'll be running back and forth.
Yeah, yeah.
You can't mix them.
And I'll go, those other people are watching me because I don't act that way with them. So on TV so if you're a performer, it's even worse then.
Yeah. What about your children? You have two children.
Oh, yeah.
And do they, have they seen any of your TV shows or stand-up ones from, like even, you were in Beverly Hills.
Beverly Hills Cop II.
That's my generation. I grew up watching that, and that's how I know you, from those shows. And I'm so funny. And do your kids watch that and crack up? Do they laugh?
It was funny. My kid, my son, when he was in preschool, the teacher said, well, we were talking to the teacher. The teacher says, he doesn't pay attention in class, and he's always trying to be funny. And I'm thinking, gee, I'll have to really confront him on it. And she asked him, she said, how did you learn how to be funny? And he said, from my daddy. And she goes, oh, your daddy's funny? And he goes, he's funny at home, not at work.
So you're funnier at home. Wow. That's very cute.
What? Question.
Yes.
Who influenced you in comedy
God, that's like so.
Is that a wide open question?
Yeah, like so many people.
So you've had a lot of influences.
Yeah, it's like I remember growing up, it's like TV was like, well, first of all, it was loads of old movies on TV back then. And it would just be everything. Like one channel had all the old Warner Brothers gangster films, mm-hmm. Bogart and Cagney, Robinson. And then the other one would be like, would have the Universal monster movies.
PIX.
Oh, yes, mm-hmm. yes.
See, I go back.
And then there was like, there was the ones that weren't classic, and those would show. Okay. And then they also had variety shows back then, so I'd watch comics there. And they still had a lot of the old guys around, like Groucho and Milton Berle and Jack Benny. And then new ones coming in all the time.
So you must love Groucho, because in the documentary there was this great picture of Groucho right behind you in your apartment.
Yeah. Of course, granted, the artist gave me that for free.
Oh, well.
So, so you know, if he had painted Hitler, I'd have that hanging.
No, it's funny you brought up Hitler.
Yes,
Stephen King said something really nice about you. If Hitler would have known you, your humor would have stopped the war in 1942.
Yes.
So that was Stephen King. So that was just great.
Yes.
So, you know, funny stuff.
How about the voiceovers? You've done so many voiceovers recently, and which ones are your favorites?
Oh, God, so many. But it's like, you know, aside from commercials and stuff like that, but, well, of course, The Parrot and Aladdin, mm-hmm. that was a great thing to be involved. I thought, oh, my God, I'm involved with something of quality. Like, I don't belong here.
Should I just go like serious for just a minute or two or three?
Yeah.
So, and I gotta spit this out quickly. I said something to you, just to go a little bit serious, because this is a lot of fun here. And I have to say this because I was a big fan of Lenny Bruce back in the days, and I have all his albums, and I used to memorize all his bits, and wherever I would be going, I would sit in the back of the airplane or a bus. I like buses, by the way.
A
lot. I wanted to be a bus driver when I was a kid. We have to talk about that later. Love buses. I would travel clear across the country on a bus. And he knows that. I love buses. So Lenny Bruce, his comedy growing up, I watched and I used to do all his bits, and he would take some really bad words and say it like 20 times in a row on stage, and then he would say, it's just a word, you know, and I'm getting to something. It might take me a little bit. It's really important. It's just a word, and that's what he said. It's just a word. And instead, if you want, and then he would say, right after he said some really bad racial words, he would say, it's just a word, and if you really want a bad word, say Governor Forbes. And this is his bit. Governor Forbes, who was the governor of Arkansas, and they wouldn't let, they wouldn't desegregate the schools. And they had to get the National Guard to come into Little Rock. It was a whole famous thing. But that was Lenny Bruce. And I watched, and I've watched you, and I digest you, and I think you're as brilliant as Lenny Bruce. And people have to understand this, and I'm developing this. This is a development. So I watch, for example, Aristocats. And a lot of bad language there, but it's tons of bad language. But you know what? They're just words. And I think my own impression, my own take of you is you're brilliant, and you're trying to convey a message. They're just words. I mean, get over it. They're just words. And that's, I think, the beauty of your humor. And the genius of your humor. That's my comment.
that's what always got me is people who use terms like, well, he used the F word, or he used the N word, or the C word. And I'm going, okay, so when you use that term, you're saying the word in your head. Everyone knows what you're talking about. Everyone is saying that word. And so why is one better than the other? You know, you're saying it aloud in your brain. And it's not like you don't know. So, but it's like, oh, we can't use that word here.
So, but you explore that, and if anybody would ever sit and think and try to think, and that, what a great word that is, think. If people would just think about really what you're doing, you're just throwing some words out there that really don't mean anything, and some people are offended, some people are not. So I think that's the genius. So if I ever have to write an essay about you, Gilbert, and I'm an essay writer at times, I will do that, because you're right in there with Lenny Bruce, who's such a comedic hero. And all of you guys owe such a great legacy to Lenny Bruce, because after Lenny Bruce was arrested for obscenity, even in New York, he was arrested and went to jail. Since him and his pioneering work, there wasn't one comedian ever since him that ever went to jail for obscenity because of the work that Lenny did. So I put you in with him in being pioneers, and that's my take.
Okay.
So that's
speaking
it.
Speaking of that, likely with your with the comedy.
He means I'm on drugs.
No, I didn't say that.
Connection.
I here. Didn't say that.
Yes.
No intimation, on nothing.
He that means I'm gonna die on the toilet with a needle in my arm. That is what he's trying to say.
Oh no.
But he doesn't pander. Yeah, because he's from where? Monmouth.
No, you know where I'm really from? I'm a Newark boy.
Yeah?
I'm from Newark, New Jersey.
Yeah.
I'm proud of it.
Now in Newark, do they pander there?
Yeah, they do, quite
they
a bit.
They do pander.
Oh, they have to pander.
Yeah.
They have
but
to.
But where you moved to, that's...
I moved to a place called East Brunswick from... Oh, yeah. Actually, I actually...
The
I,
place where no one panders.
No, but no panders. But actually, yeah. I was in New York for 2 years. I married my wife. She was a Brooklyn girl. It pained me. By the way, it pained me to go on a date to pay a toll to go over to Verrazano Bridge. It pained me to do that. And I almost didn't do it, so I don't know where you'd be. I didn't want to pay a toll. I mean, that to me, that was an affront to my sanity. To pay a toll to go out on a date. And so we wound up getting married 2 years. Lived in Brooklyn for 2 years. I say I served in Brooklyn for 2 years. It was like penal.
I grew up in Brooklyn.
I'm sorry about that.
I'm a Brooklyn girl.
Well, but you're a Bronx guy.
No, Brooklyn.
Brooklyn.
Well, you're Brooklyn?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, so.
Jersey City. On my podcast, we often go into how many famous people came out of Brooklyn.
Tons.
Yeah.
Tons. Brooklyn is like, I mean, the whole singing business. You know, Neil and Barbara.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, they're all Brooklyn people. You're Jersey City.
Yeah.
So you and I were neighbors, you know.
Yes, we were.
Right.
I watched
Jersey.
You pander many times.
Yes. You know, and I spent one of the great summers, the summer of love in 65 in Jersey City. You know, Rutgers had, I'm a Rutgers guy. I always wear a hat. But I went to summer school in Jersey City. Did you know that? I shouldn't be talking about this now.
I didn't realize 65 was the summer of love.
Well, either. That's what they called it. I called it that.
Just 65?
I called it that.
Or was that your summer of love?
It was, well, it was the summer of love, but there was no summer of love for me.
Oh.
It was a barren summer.
Oh, my goodness. Too busy paying the toll to get over the Verrazano.
All right, moving on.
Stand up, you have the stand up comedy. Do you do anything, like, when you pick the people, is it. People who, when we were talking about what words they use and what they don't, is there any kind of regulations you have when you book a stand-up comedian, or do you just say go for it?
There are no regulations, but it's what the audience and the market will bear. So if you're a family audience, we have X-rated material warnings for Gilbert when he performs, because there is X-rated material, and some people are not into that,
mm-hmm.
And they're welcome to walk out. I'm not giving them a refund. Walk out of the offense. We're an equal opportunity offender.
But then that's not even a bad thing, right? If they walk out, that means you kind of...
That's a good thing. Yeah. That's a good thing.
So what do you like best? So you're an actor, and you have a podcast, and you do stand-up, and you do voiceovers. So what is your favorite thing to do?
Wherever someone's waving a check in my face, it's like at that particular moment, I go, oh, I kind of enjoy this. Yeah.
Okay. I bet you the Aladdin was probably good for that, right?
Oh, yeah. Aladdin was fun. Yeah, there was a few. And now I'm a bird in this. They're still making these cyber chase cartoons for PBS.
Oh. Birds.
Yeah.
Lots of birds. when they do the character, do they try to do facial expressions that you do?
In Aladdin they did that. They actually had cameras on the people while they were recording them, and then they like kind of design the facial expressions
according
around
to, like,
how
structure.
The actors.
That's awesome. Yeah, so you really had to fully act, even though you weren't on camera. You had to do everything. That's fun.
It is fun.
You know, Gilbert's been with Catch a Rising Star since the beginning, pretty much, right? 72?
Oh, God, yeah.
Yeah, let's talk about your history with Catch a Rising Star. That's great. I'm glad you brought that up.
When it was on first, and I think 77th. Yeah.
So you go way back. So you were almost you were a kid.
Yeah. Like I was a teenager.
And that's when you started with Catch a Rising Star.
Yeah.
And that's why you're here now.
And they, I remember there was like, they used to have singers at comedy clubs. And among the singers, Pat Benatar was there every night.
Wow.
And then later on, Patti Smyth. And a lot of people.
And then
there.
I think Rick left the business to be with Pat Benatar.
He was her manager for a while.
He said, that's it.
Wow.
Yeah.
Nice.
So you go back to starting your comedy at Catch a Rising Star when Richard Nixon was president.
Sorry about that.
Do you think that was your big break going at with Catch a Rising Star? Is that where your big break was, or was there something else?
I don't know. I always feel funny with when they say a break, because I feel like it's usually a series of things that add up.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of like I was on Saturday Night Live for a season, and they said, was that your big break? And I thought, no, it was a terrible time to be on Saturday Night Live. And my other big break was when Alan Thicke had the talk show Thick of the Night,
mm-hmm.
which was another colossal failure. And but he did write, compose, and sing the theme song to Thick of the Night, because he was a jingle writer too. But and it went as follows. Mama don't leave the night and I'm on the road tonight. Everyone needs a dream to hold on. I want to make it on my own. Running in the thick of the night, under the city lights. Running in the thick of the night. And then years ago, I was switch wives with him on in real life.
Oh, wife swap.
No, I in the celebrity wife swap.
You were on that? That's good. That's a good one.
That was your big break.
Yeah. Yes.
you do like great impersonations. So
I discovered, I think we talked about it at the house for briefly, but I discovered one of the funniest things I've ever heard when you and Howard were on radio and you called Jerry Seinfeld. And he was supposed to call in and he didn't, so Howard picks up the phone and Howard Stern.
Yeah.
Anybody doesn't know, it's Howard Stern. Howard Stern and Gilbert are together and they pick up the phone and they call Jerry's answering machine. So this is all improv. And you did 40 minutes of Seinfeld impersonation.
And that was when they had answering machines.
Yes.
And that could run out. And we stayed on until it ran out.
43 minutes.
And I just kept going like, why do people wear shoes? Is it because they want to cover their feet? Why do people have breakfast? Is it too early for lunch?
It was great. It was great.
In fact, I remember when in my early days at the clubs when Seinfeld was there all the time, and you know, he wasn't known. He was just another comic. I started imitating him just to amuse myself and the other people who worked there. And I would go on stage and I'd start imitating him, and the other comics and the wait staff would all be cracking up. The audience had no idea who he was. And the only person who wouldn't be in the room when I was doing that would be Seinfeld, who would be angrily pacing the bar going, "That doesn't sound anything like me. I don't have a sing-song voice."
If anybody out there, just go find it on YouTube and just sit and listen to it. It's just unbridled, wonderful, wonderful humor.
Did Jerry Seinfeld appreciate it when he got the message?
Whatever happened?
Yeah, that's a good question. Great question.
Yeah, really. I don't know. Oh. I'm sure he was thrilled.
What about you? I mean, your voice is classic. Anyone hears your voice, they know it's you. Who does your best impersonation?
Ooh, God, so I've heard it so many times. Well, I mean, you know,
it's a great question.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, Jimmy Fallon does a funny imitation of me.
Okay.
Weirdest imitation of me that I wish I could go back in time and have it on film. I was at a party many years ago, and O.J. Simpson was there. When O.J. was known as a football player and sometime actor, he wasn't known. It wasn't, O.J. and, he's that guy who killed his family. No, and O.J. Simpson did an imitation of me, because he was a fan, and so I'd like to go back. Notice I'd say I'd like to go back in time and film that, where maybe I should go back in time and stop the him. Murders yes. from happening. Maybe I should say, Nicole, maybe you can go do your hair. And Mr. Goldman, she doesn't need her sunglasses that day. Really, she's got plenty of sunglasses.
funny. I've watched so much of you, and again, this gets a little serious. You often make a comment in the documentary, and also on that other documentary, you can't take a joke, which was another brilliant. By the way, your documentary, I jump around a lot.
Yes, just, you do.
It is I do. Well, he knows that. I am what I am. That's Popeye. I am what I am, and I cannot, at this advanced age, change. So, but back to the documentary, it is just a who's who of American comedy in that. Everybody is in that documentary. So if anybody has any proclivities, to American comedy. It's a great word. Mm. I looked it up before I came here. I just wanted to try to impress you. You. So, just about everybody, it's just a who's who of American comedy all jumping in. I mean, just everybody. So it's just...
And where can they get the documentary, people?
I think it was on Hulu.
Yeah, Hula.
Well, I bought it on Amazon.
You can buy it also.
Yeah, I bought it on Amazon. I'm a big fan of Jeff Bezos, so I like to support
him. I'm also in a documentary, well, this came out years ago, called Life Animated.
Oh.
Which was, that was a peculiar story. Because I didn't know anything about it. I just saw there was an article in the Times about a guy who, this Ron Suss guy and a writer, who had a son who was autistic, and he couldn't communicate with him. But the son would watch Disney films 24 hours a day. And so one time he went into the son's room, and there was a puppet on the floor of my character Iago from Aladdin. And the father put it on his hand and did an imitation of me. And he said his son reacted like this was an old friend. And they got into a conversation.
Oh, wow. That's beautiful.
That is beautiful. Wow. That's a great story.
Which proves I can do great things as long as I'm not directly involved. Yeah. It's when I become directly involved. That's when the police have to come in. So, okay, we're going to show you on the doll.
Okay, we can bring up one crazy thing that 50 Shades of Grey.
Oh, yes.
You read that. That's just insanely funny. I mean, the people listening to you read that. Now, who asked you to do this? Like,
yeah,
where did this even
it was
come
just,
from?
It was just this company, I think, College Humor, and they said, we want you to read passages of 50 Shades of Grey.
Did you think this was insane?
That was fun.
Looked like you were having fun.
A lot of people watched that.
So funny.
Yeah.
You know, we can't talk about it really, though. No. But it was very funny.
No. So, I started to say, and I got sidetracked, you say, I don't play it safe. And you don't, and segueing, because I think you're brave. You're a comedic pioneer, like driving around in a Conestoga wagon. And you say, I don't play it safe, and even testament to that is your conviction. You did a benefit for the kids, your kids' grammar school.
Oh, yeah.
And you were Gilbert Gottfried.
Yeah.
And I think that's just absolutely testament to who you are and what you are and what you believe in, and all part of the whole package. And so that's really brave to do that. And then you did a benefit for
there was St. Jude's Hospital.
Yeah, I was just going there.
Yeah,
and everybody got up and applauded you because you did your thing. At St. Jude's Hospital.
Yeah.
With all those parents and all those people and the kids and this. And they all got up and applauded you.
Yeah.
Because they appreciated you. So I just had to bring that up because, you know, that's...
if anyone didn't
It's not
know,
pandering
it's
again.
Yeah, because he doesn't pander.
I don't pander.
Section of Jersey, that is, where they don't pander. Not, some sections of Jersey, they pander like crazy. But his section of Jersey, they're known for not pandering.
Oh, gosh.
What section of Jersey is that again?
Mammoth County.
Mammoth County. If you want to know who's from Mammoth County, if you're talking to someone and you go, this guy's not pandering. he must be from Mammoth County.
It's really Mammoth.
Mammoth.
You know that.
Yes.
It's really Mammoth. Because we don't want to get in trouble because that's our home base. You know, we don't want to get in trouble.
Now, in the comedian world.
I think it was Al Jolson who sang Mammoth.
He did. He did.
Yes.
Yes.
Would you want your son to go and become a comedian?
That to me is so strange now, because it's like back then I thought I really had stupidity on my side. Like I thought, I could go into show business, like I wasn't thinking of the odds. I wasn't thinking of the rejection. I'll make a living in show business. Like, how? Now it seems insane when I think about it. And like, so now when anybody tells me, oh, well, I'm an aspiring actor or comic, I think, what, you nuts? It's kind of like I'd rather my kids say to me, well, what we're going to do is we're going to walk down the street and stop at the trash cans and take out soda cans and bottles and turn it in for the 5 cent deposit. At least that makes sense. Like, in show business, zero sense.
It's a hard...
Yeah, it's difficult.
It's a hard, hard world. And it's changing. Comedy is changing. That was a question we threw over here. Comedy is...
I just wanted to, while we're on this point, what about your family? Were they supportive? How young were you when you first started going
First time I got up on a stage, I was 15.
And 15?
Yeah.
And where was that?
You know what? That's so funny. I had it in my mind of one club, and then my sister said, no, it was a different club. So I don't know what club I started
but
at.
But it was a club at 15?
Yeah, that's great. It was one of these clubs, like, where you'd sign your name down in a book, and, when they got to you, they go, okay, and so-and-so comedian, or so-and-so singer. And
right, so it's kind of like open mic now.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Is it Pips, maybe, in Brooklyn?
No. It was in Manhattan, but I don't remember where. But first time, it wasn't the first time, but one time I worked Pips, and my opening act was Andrew Dice Clay.
Oh.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Woof.
How'd you do after his lineup?
It was totally different back then. Wow. Yeah.
A bunch of years ago, I was going to Texas I used to work in the eyeglass business. That's where I play with my eyeglass. And my sister-in-law gave me this tape, Aunt Lo. I'm saying Aunt Lo on my favorite sister-in-law, my only sister-in-law. So she gave me a tape, and I had no idea who it was. It was Andrew Dice Clay, his first cassette tape. And I put it on the plane, and I got hysterical laughing the whole time. And stewardesses, flight attendants, there were stewardesses back then. Yeah. Everybody came running by, who you're listening to, and I was afraid to tell anybody because, he was a little controversial. I love comedians, and so I can't do your voice, so you're safe. But anyway, I started to do Andrew Dice Clay. I don't know if you remember, but people started saying, Calvin, you're starting to sound like Andrew Dice Clay. So I was doing a lot of his bits and stuff.
Oh,
and his aunt lived around the corner from me in Monmouth County. End of.
Yes. Monmouth County. So since we're getting close to the end, do we want to do our questions?
I think we
put everybody on the spot.
Yes, these are fun questions.
Oh boy.
If these are fun questions, I'll start.
Okay.
Gilbert Gottfried. Living or dead, who would you like to have dinner with?
Oh, boy, whoever's willing to pay the check.
Okay.
That's good.
Could be Genghis Khan. Okay. I don't care. As long as he goes, I'll take care of that.
Okay. Susie.
Yeah, I'm going to narrow it down to the comedy world, because that's a tough question. Okay. That's a lot of people.
It's a lot of people.
I would say Joan Rivers.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I watch Joan Rivers. I love comedy. So I sit and I watch old Johnny Carson shows obsessively. So she was on a bunch of years ago before she did that bad thing with Johnny. And she was talking about that model, that pretty model who, oh, shoot. But anyway, she said something so funny about
Anyway, I shouldn't even. But anyway, she happens to be priceless. She's so priceless, and you talk about her all the time too. You know, you're always mentioning Joan Rivers.
We were speaking about her the other day, saying if she said some of the things that were being said today, would they be accepted because she said them? Because she was such an insult comic.
Correct. Correct. So funny, and you know, all her times on Carson,
and I watch incessantly old comedy, including yourself. But you're not old comedy, but I just love it. So
should I hit the next question?
Yes, you do.
Okay, this is a crazy question too. So I'll ask you first: five things that you cannot live without.
Oh boy.
I'm going to write it down.
Yeah.
I'm going to write
yeah,
this down.
I don't know if I can think of one. five things.
Like a bus.
Yeah, yeah.
Can I help you?
Yeah, all right. You say five things and I'll go right along with them. Yeah.
Okay, well, bus. A bus.
Sorry. Okay.
It's difficult.
A heart. Lungs.
Okay.
These are things I can't live without.
Okay.
Spinal cord.
Okay.
That's
yeah.
Important.
That's good. That's good.
kidneys.
Okay.
Yeah. How many is that so far?
I think you're there.
Yeah.
You got
okay.
You're there.
Right.
You got
yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Couldn't live on any of those. Yeah.
Okay. Your turn.
Susie.
Let's see. Telephone. Hot springs, natural hot springs.
Really? Do you go a lot?
Ooh.
Really?
Oh yeah.
We have to talk about that.
Yeah.
Everywhere.
Where's your favorite one?
In Arkansas?
No, it was in New Mexico.
New Mexico.
10,000 waves.
Wow.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Amazing.
Uh-huh.
Let's see what else. My memories.
That's nice.
Okay.
My dreams.
Fine. Dreams
keep
good.
Going.
Oh,
dreams
scratching
good.
The surface now. And Gilbert. I'm going to say oh.
Perfect. 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 All right. One more serious.
One more question.
They're fun. Serious. And this won't involve any organs or anything. But so Gilbert Gottfried. I should do This Is Your Life.
Yeah.
You remember that show?
Oh,
Ralph
yeah.
Edwards? Okay. It's so nice to talk to a contemporary. it's so nice. You all don't know what the hell we're talking about, but this is nice. This is your life, Ralph Edwards.
I remember that.
I always
yeah.
dreamed of being.
I remember
you know,
it.
Do you remember that?
Yeah.
So you're up there too.
I'm
I don't think you're up there.
So,
Gilbert Gottfried, before you leave this earth, I won't be satisfied. Fill in the blank. I won't be satisfied until I blank. It's heavy stuff.
Yeah, see, I hate these questions.
Oh.
Because they always ask that so they could put it in your obituary.
Oh, stop.
Yeah. They always, every time they say to a celebrity, so what do you want on your tombstone?
I didn't ask that.
Yeah.
I didn't ask that. I don't mess around with that stuff.
What would you like to scream out as you're dying? Could you do like your last wheezing breath for us, just in case we're not fortunate enough to watch it?
Okay, so enough said. this was not a funereal question.
Yeah,
this
was it was not a venereal question.
No, it wasn't a venereal.
No, it was. This was not a question where your urine starts getting a burning sensation. Yeah.
This was just a nice little.
Yeah, yes.
I had to,
not a venereal.
No, it wasn't venereal. It wasn't funereal.
Yeah.
It wasn't ethereal. I mean, yes. We're going to get into all that. Susie, now I'm switching over to you.
We're not getting the answer from Gilbert.
No, it's fine. It's fine.
Let's see.
He answered it. You know.
I can't. Repeat the question, please.
Before I leave this earth, I won't be satisfied until I blank.
I'm going to say until I become the person I used to dream I would be when I was little.
Okay. That's very nice.
That is very nice.
That is.
So, they are getting two fingers. I hate when these people back there give me the finger. Yeah. I hate that. I hate that. So, before we say our goodbyes, I just want one more time to say up and coming things with Gilbert in the Garden State, the state of pandering.
Yes.
The state of all this stuff. This is the state of pandering. Yeah, it is the state of pandering because we had a governor. I don't want to talk about it. No politics.
No.
Anyway, Gilbert will be a Catch a Rising Star at Joey Harrison's in Forked River on July 21st. CatchARisingStar.com. And as I mentioned earlier, it's a great venue because it's on the water and there's beautiful boats nearby and the water smells good.
And they have a great CEO.
Yeah. Great CEO, that's right. And then, and I really mean this, because you do a lot of stuff with old, like older movies on your podcast.
Yeah.
You talk about older, like legendary type of actors like M. Emmett Walsh.
He was.
1 minute. All right. So anyway, Gilbert Gottfried is amazing. I'm getting there now. It's one finger. Gilbert Gottfried's amazing, colossal
this
podcast.
One's giving him the finger.
Yes, the finger.
He's giving another finger.
Another finger. This, that, and that. But anyway, GilbertPodcast.com. Check it out because it's wonderful just to sit and listen. I play backgammon and I listen to it. It's wonderful. And also, Gilbert the God documentary is available on Hulu, iTunes, Amazon. Go to gilbertmovie.com. This is it, it's a treat. By the way, it's this is our closing.
Yeah, this was great. Thank you so much for having us on our show.
The best.
Thank you.
By the way, you made my day, you made my week, you made my year. This is beyond. Wow. I can even I'm going to write an essay and send it to you what this meant to me.
Thank you.
And no, I am.
And I think it was Roseanne Barr who said no, I don't know.
By the way, you know,
comedian, say goodbye.
Thanks. Oh, we're saying goodbye. We don't even get a chance to talk about Roseanne.
Yes.
Wave goodbye.
They don't pander.